think Cedar Rapids ought to have an orchestra? Those prophetic words, posed in a rhetorical question by insurance agent E.A. Hazelton to his friend, Dr. J. Lynn Crawford, in 1922, were the catalyst of a community-minded movement that is now 100 years into its future. Now featuring more than 70 professional musicians and recognized as one of the top regional symphony orchestras in the nation, 2023 will mark Orchestra Iowa's 100th season.
100 years is a great round number, but it's an impressive one because arts organizations are always under stress, especially symphony orchestras as well. We are no exception. But to come to this, this milestone is an indication of how much this community loves its orchestra and how much it stood by this orchestra through a long history of ups and downs. And so this is a really important moment for us to not only celebrate it, that we made it this far, but also to reinvigorate it so we'll be here in another 100 years.
In concert with Hazelton and Crawford, Dr. Joseph H. Kitchen, professor of violin and music theory at the Coe Music Conservatory, helped found the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra. The inaugural performance was on April 13th, 1923.
Cedar Rapids Evening Gazette, Saturday, April 14, 1923. Symphony concert surprises critics. Professor Joseph Kitchen wields baton capably. Future is promising. The beginning of symphonic music for Cedar Rapids was made Friday evening when the newly founded Symphony Orchestra gave its initial concert. Among the audience, which packed the Coe College Chapel, there may have been many who came there with doubts about the artistic possibilities of an orchestra recruited entirely from local talent. However, it was but a short while until the fact was revealed that in the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra, our city possesses an organization of surprising achievements.
Dr. Kitchen was a gifted teacher and ideally suited to bringing out the best in an orchestra composed entirely of amateur musicians. All proud members of the community, schooled in their respective instruments to some degree, but most important, eager to make the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra a success.
When I started playing, we played in the Veterans Memorial Coliseum. The players, there were good musicians in town because of teachers, but there was a lot of local people that were lawyers, doctors, all professions.
Performances were well received over the years and ran uninterrupted throughout the Great Depression and World War II, making the Cedar Rapids Symphony one of the oldest continuously operating symphonies west of the Mississippi River.
The Cedar Rapids Gazette, Sunday, June 1, 1952. Cedar Rapids has had a symphony orchestra for nearly 30 years. It has been of great value to the community, value that cannot be measured in dollars and cents, or even in the huge number of voluntary hours that have contributed to its existence.
The 1952-53 season was a grand finale for Joseph Kitchen. After 31 years of leadership as resident conductor, his last concert was May 13, 1953. A nationwide search led by Dr. Kitchen was launched, and Henry Denneke, who for 13 years was timpanist with the Minneapolis Symphony Orchestra, was named as the first full-time conductor of the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra. Selected from a field of more than 50 applicants, Denneke was conductor of the Minneapolis Civic Orchestra and Northwest Sinfonietta. Denneke's influence on the orchestra was immediately made apparent by the revitalized performances of the musicians and increased ticket sales. During his first season as musical director, the symphony attracted more people to its concerts than any previous year.
The Cedar Rapids Gazette, Thursday, May 1, 1954. No organization in Cedar Rapids has made a greater increase in its civic contribution and in its individual development than has the Symphony Orchestra this year. All this is over and above the improved quality of the orchestra in its first season under the direction of Henry Denneke.
I didn't audition for the horn position. I just walked in because it so happened that Henry Denneke played in the Minneapolis Symphony, and he knew my teacher in college, Paul Binstock. So he thought, she can play French horn.
In the never-ending quest to increase budget and gain a larger audience for the orchestra, the need for volunteer support was identified by the wife of the conductor, Julia Denneke. She created the Women's Committee of the Cedar Rapids Symphony with the help of community-spirited women.
I was a member of what we used to call the Women's Committee, which then later on became the Symphony Guild because it was not good to be the Women's Committee.
These volunteers brought fundraising to a new level, producing galas, guest artist and celebrity luncheons, and post-concert receptions, as well as planning and executing educational activities and scholarship competitions. After serving 16 years as both the conductor and manager of the orchestra, it was announced that the 1969-70 season would be Henry Denneke's last. Richard Williams was named music director in 1970. Williams immediately went to work to improve musicianship.
He was kind of surprised, I guess, that there had been no auditions for most of the positions. He just come in and show me what you can do type of thing. And one of the things he did established that there would be a contract between the musicians and the orchestra.
The Cedar Rapids Gazette, Tuesday, October 6, 1970. Richard Williams has successful debut. Richard Williams debuted as director of the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra Monday night before a cheering capacity audience in Coe's Sinclair Auditorium. The opening concert of the 1970-71 concert season saw the unveiling of a fine and large orchestra teeming with musicians of proven ability.
The Cedar Rapids Symphony was transitioning into a fully professional orchestra as an increasing number of players from the University of Iowa School of Music strengthened each section. The improvements were noticed, the audience doubled, and programming increased. The welcome growth of orchestra and audience created another challenge to the board. Just as the orchestra had outgrown Veterans Memorial Coliseum, now the Sinclair Auditorium was not big enough to seat many new concertgoers the symphony was attracting.
Rich was the guy that took one look and said, we're going to change this. We're going to make this symphony orchestra an important part of Cedar Rapids and its future. That was true. Those are the two things we needed, more professional players and a better venue. Because at that time, the Paramount was just empty. Nobody was using it. At that time, it was owned by Pete Bazanson. Rich got him talked into how he did that. I don't know, into actually being willing to donate the Paramount to the city. That was a trick. And then we had to go from there to get the city to approve the purchase of it. We went to see the mayor, and Rich and I and Don Canny were, and it was all just the three of us. Rich said, will you accept the gift of the Paramount Theater to the city? And Rich Canny looked at me and said, can you raise $1 million from your organization, meaning the symphony board and so on? And I said, yes, I can do that. He said, okay, it's done. And that was it, it was done.
The work of the guild and the commitment of the community was critical to not only raise the money needed to buy the Paramount, but also to upgrade its structure from movie house to a performing arts theater.
That was a traumatic time. You know, obviously a huge challenge for not only Rich, but the board and the board of directors and the people who were involved with the symphony in any way, and trying to make this thing come about.
A variety of fundraising and audience development efforts were implemented, including outreach campaigns in Marion, which culminated in Arthur Fiedler's concert at the Paramount, as well as runout concerts in Monticello, Fairfield, and Independence.
I'm Kent Williams. I'm the oldest son of Richard Williams, who conducted the Cedar Rapids Symphony from 1970 to 1980. This is Rich speaking. I have always thought of Cedar Rapids as special. The board of directors, the women's committee, and co-college are very important to the success of the symphony. I've been very fortunate and have recorded and performed with some of the world's great orchestras. But because of the Cedar Rapids musicians and friends, and the experiences we all shared, my years in Cedar Rapids were some of the best in my life.
In December 1980, Williams announced he would leave the symphony at the end of the 1980-81 season. He told the Gazette it was the most difficult decision he had ever made. Quote, "I love the community. It's been so supportive and special to me." In 1981, Dr. Christian Tiemeyer, associate conductor of the Dallas Symphony, was named music director. A native of Maryland, Tiemeyer became the youngest member of the Baltimore Symphony at age 18. Under Tiemeyer's leadership, the concert series menu was expanded. He also firmly believed education was the key to future growth of the symphony.
I would say he was a great builder, organizational builder, behind the scenes, the symphony school, and just making sure we had a full schedule.
Christian came in with some very solid ideas about what he wanted to do and how he wanted to employ more musicians. So I was given the opportunity to find them teaching and lessons and in mix with the schools and everything to make sure that they got more employment.
At its height, there were as many as 900 students involved in the symphony school, which provided welcome employment for many musicians.
Well, I love my musicians. I say they're my musicians, but I mean, I love them because they work so hard. I think that the layperson has no idea the study and the practice that goes into just being able to play this kind of music and to have so many of these talented musicians in the area who are struggling to make a living. And to do so, they have to play in a variety of orchestras and they have to teach on the side, maybe have a side hustle.
Efforts to increase the orchestra's regional outreach included performances held in various Iowa City venues, including Hancher Auditorium, and occasional run-out concerts to other communities. The most visible fundraiser was The Follies, a show created by the Orchestra Guild that took on a life of its own. The Follies featured local talent performing highlights in the tradition of New York's Broadway musicals, and within a short period, brought in busloads of new concert goers from surrounding areas.
We're programming not just for the tastes and the culture of Cedar Rapids, but what's going on in Iowa City? What's going on in North Liberty, in Coralville, and Shewellville? Part of our mission of community building is also about this idea of creating a sense of the corridor, of a regional area.
I certainly had a lot of respect for Christian Tiemeyer, for the quality that he brought to the program, to the podium, and to the commitment that he had to making things better all the time. The philosophy that we shared during those years really centered the orchestra in the community. We had some national recognition, New York Times, Time Magazine, and what both of those critics spoke about was the importance of the relationship between the orchestra and its community.
In a July 19, 1993 editorial, citing the article in Time magazine, the Cedar Rapids Gazette, titled "Doing Cedar Rapids Proud," the symphony was lauded. Dr. Tiemeyer is doing what any institution must do to survive. Innovate, think smarter, take risks, and invest in the future. Not to mention what it's doing for classical music. The Paramount Theater, home of the symphony, had seen very little attention to its structure, both exterior and interior. In 2002, a strategic plan was initiated to address its needs.
There was no place to store anything in the theater itself, and so the 2003 renovation gave us that opportunity to really look at how do we best use the Paramount space in partnership with this space to really create a seamless flow for some of those performances, equipment, artists, you know, coming back and forth.
I think the other thing was is that just, you know, the place was dingy, mm-hmm. right? It was, you know, a former movie theater.
Now, we did get a nice grant from the Hall Perrine Foundation. We got a nice grant from the state, a community attraction and tourism grant. But we also raised a lot of money from, you know, people who had had their first date and gone to the movies at the Paramount or gone to some kind of a performance, you know, through the years. So we were able to really shine the place up as well. We got the fixtures all cleaned and so on and so forth, and it really was cool. We spent some money out front in the Hall of Mirrors as well.
As Jim said, when we had that grand opening, you know, when it was all done, it just, the joy and the momentum of going forward, that the building had been preserved for the next generations to have those same kind of memories that the older generations had. It was just a really awesome part of what came out of all of it.
Christian T. Meyer stepped down from the podium in 2004 after leading the orchestra for 23 years.
I'm truly proud to say that I was on the search committee that brought in Tim Hankovich. And that was very interesting because we had guest conductors all through that whole season, ultimately culminating in the hiring of Maestro Tim Hankovich.
According to the committee's chair, Denny Redmond, the question was, is Timothy the best person to lead the CRSO into the future? And we answered yes. All five candidates were excellent, and it was a difficult decision, but in the end, Timothy Hankovich clearly rose above the other four.
He is just of the highest quality. He really is. And I say that because we always had great musicians. He took it to an entirely another level.
Tim had his conducting style was very clear. He had a way of relating to players, or just emotionally, the players could understand him well, and they just that first year they just gelled, and it's been a good rapport between the players and Tim.
The Cedar Rapids Gazette, Monday, May 17, 2007. 1 year in, the Symphony Orchestra and its new maestro are making happy music together. On the podium, Hankovich directs the symphony with authority, yet bridges the gap between himself and his audiences by creating an open, relaxing atmosphere. This is not your stereotypical stuffy, standoffish symphony maestro.
In an interview on KGAN, Hankovich related that, as music director of Orchestra Iowa, his mission is to break the stereotype of a typical symphony audience. Quote, "We touch the lives of tens of thousands of children through our educational outreach programs, and in terms of our Masterwork series, our audiences are becoming more and more diverse, both in terms of age, gender, and race."
In this day and age, I think our society could use a lot more empathy to each other. We are a very polarized society right now, and there needs to be safe places to heal and safe places to reflect and to think. And that's what the classical arts do. That is the difference between art and entertainment, and Orchestra Iowa is here to make a community better. And because of my upbringing, I believe that the classical arts are a powerful social glue that brings people together.
Just 1 year after Tim Hankovich took the baton of the Orchestra Iowa, the Symphony's school, administrative offices, and the Paramount Theater were destroyed by a devastating flood, which crested on June 13, 2008. In addition to damage to the buildings, the symphony lost musical instruments, production equipment, and its entire office infrastructure.
So, you know, people don't realize that it looked like 10 feet of water outside,
right.
35 feet of water. And I started to cry. I really did, because they were bashing plaster off of the front of the balcony because it was ruined. There were a number of people, particularly the Five Seasons Commission, who oversaw the building, said we ought to tear it down and build a new performing arts center somewhere else. Let's just say that I was opposed to that. We all kind of came together and said, what in the heck are we going to do? Because it was just a monstrously huge endeavor to try to put this back together again, to basically oversee the reconstruction of the Paramount Theater. I say that word, and it's important, reconstruction of the Paramount Theater. This was not a renovation. This was a reconstruction. This was an absolutely huge project. So $35 million later, this building was, I think, positioned really for the next 50 years.
Absolutely.
So out of disaster comes opportunity.
Mm-hmm. How do we redesign all of those spaces for the future, all the work that went into the thought process, and then the collaborations between not only the user groups but with Ryan and OPN to bring that to life is just, it's just incredible to what Cedar Rapids has as a jewel here in this building.
While the Paramount was being reconstructed, the symphony rallied, and the 2008-2009 season began on schedule.
We had the flood of 2008, and Tim right away, the next day, secured the places in West High School in Iowa City for concerts, and he also brought about Bruce Moore as a place that we could play. And those Bruce Moore concerts, oh my goodness, the first one really was just so amazing because people were thrilled to be able to hear an orchestra after this horrible thing had happened to the city.
After opening with the outdoor concert on the lawn of the historic Bruce Moore Mansion, the concert series continued uninterrupted at various venues in the corridor and beyond. In addition, the orchestra established partnerships with National Public Radio's From the Top program, Iowa Public Television, and Iowa Public Radio, as well as initiating permanent relationships with the Cedar Rapids Opera Theater and Ballet Quad Cities.
And so to this day, that has inspired me to make sure that whatever we do with Orchestra Iowa is about community building.
Transitioning from its home in the Paramount Theater to perform across the state and other cities in the Midwest forced the orchestra to become more adaptable.
And if we were going to be performing in other places like Iowa City, Davenport, Fairfield, Mason City, these were all communities that we were relying on to keep our art alive. And so it was with great reluctance that we changed our name from the Cedar Rapids Symphony Orchestra to Orchestra Iowa. But Orchestra Iowa now reflects who we are because we play throughout the state. Our patrons and donorship comes from throughout the entire state. And so it was a mixed blessing, but the positive that came out of the flood was our audiences exploded beyond our city borders.
On November 3rd, 2012, following 4 years of recovery and renovation, Orchestra Iowa reopened the Paramount Theater's doors to a sold-out performance by Harry Connick Jr., accompanied by the orchestra. Since then, The orchestra has continued to add to its rich history with monumental moments, such as the commission, performance, and recording of Grammy Award-winning and Iowa native composer Michael Dougherty's American Gothic.
I'll have to throw out one big compliment when I hear Jane Walker play flute and her husband David Hempel play oboe, and I just think, I lucked out. And plenty of other colleagues as well who were very dedicated. And as I came to learn, a public that was dedicated to the love of music and to making sure this organization continued.
On August 10th, 2020, with very little time to prepare, a derecho hit Cedar Rapids, bringing 140 mile per hour winds and causing widespread devastation throughout every corner of the city. Orchestra Iowa's library was a casualty of the derecho.
So one thing a lot of people don't realize about orchestras is that music is an extraordinarily valuable asset for any symphony orchestra. And for us, we realized that by losing that much music, we were on the hook for about $40,000 to $50,000 worth of material that was actually soaked in the derecho or as a result of the derecho. So on Valentine's Day of 2021, we launched a new campaign called Save Our Scores, and it was an opportunity tied into Valentine's Day to show your love for your local symphony orchestra. And so the first day that it was launched, the response was enormous. People came out of the woodwork to support the orchestra and to show their love of the music and of the symphony. And by the end of the second day, we had about 66% of the entire listing completely covered already. A lot of people that wanted to recognize the value of the music and recognize the opportunity to connect to their history and their people that were close to them to support the orchestra and to bring back the music.
Like all other performing arts organizations, Orchestra Iowa was seriously impacted by the global pandemic caused by COVID-19. Many concerts from March 2020 through the 2021 season were canceled or postponed. To keep the orchestra relevant and raise community spirits, to say the least, Hankowich launched his virtual Happy Hour with Maestro Tim. The maestro kept everyone entertained with stories on his personal tales, intermingled with an eclectic melange of charming guests.
And after 540 days of silence from the last concert prior to the pandemic to Bruce Orchestra in 2021, we finally were able to launch and bring the community back together for this great celebration of live music back up on the grounds of Bruce Moore. So the attendance at Bruce Orchestra in 2021 was extraordinary. It was one of the highest attended Bruce Orchestras that we've ever had. People were craving live music. They were craving an opportunity to get back out there and just share in a community event and a feel of just being together and sharing in this with their neighbors.
Bruce Orchestra 14 kicked off a full season schedule for 2021-22. Today, the orchestra is robust and better than ever before, and determined to continually enhance its prowess and rapport within the community.
So I am extraordinarily excited about our 100th anniversary. I mean, it doesn't get any bigger than this, and we are digging deep to make our birthday party the best celebration ever. With the repertoire that we're playing and the guest artists that we're inviting to join us on stage, this season is as much about investing in our future and showcasing these amazing individuals who are sort of leading the way for those to follow, to say, hey, this is such a great art form. You need to follow in our footsteps. And so whether you've come to the orchestra or not, I invite you to join us for this season because you are gonna love it.
As a vibrant arts enterprise, Orchestra Iowa continues to connect Iowans through the world of music. And the driving force of Orchestra Iowa's existence remains consistent, a strong and caring relationship with the community.
I mean, we have one of the finest symphony orchestras in the entire Midwest, bar none. And I'm not saying that just because I live in Cedar Rapids. We really, really do have a hell of a band.
Don't you think Cedar Rapids ought to have an orchestra?